I want to welcome you to this 12th and final session in our series on the Gospel of John. Throughout this series, we've emphasized that the Apostle John wrote for a specific purpose that he shares with us in John 20, 30 and 31, that there were many other miraculous signs that Jesus did do in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book, but these are written, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. So throughout the Gospel of John, we've noticed the differences between John and the other three Gospels. Not a different Jesus, but a different way of presenting him. John says, I want to present him in ways that will forever help people come to faith in him. John's audience is primarily that audience at the near the end of the first century, in the west side of modern-day Turkey, in the area of Ephesus. We know through Revelation that there's these seven churches of what's called Asia. Not Asia as we think of it today, but what was called Asia Minor at that time, modern-day Western Turkey. And so John has an audience that he's working with. Recall that we learn a little bit about this audience in Acts chapter 19, when the Apostle Paul, following Apollos, goes through to Ephesus in Acts 19. He asks them a question that is actually associated with our previous session. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? And when they say, we haven't even heard there's a Holy Spirit, then the Apostle Paul says, well then, what baptism did you receive? And they said, well, we received the baptism of John. Paul says, that was the baptism pointing to Jesus. And they are baptized in the name of Jesus and receive the Holy Spirit. That audience had been introduced to both John the Baptist and Jesus and had some difficulty sorting them out. So when we look at the Gospel of John, the very first chapter, we see John beginning to identify who is Jesus. Who is John the Baptist? And then very clearly, here's who John the Baptist isn't. So there's this light coming into the world, but that's not John the Baptist. John the Baptist is a man sent from God. His name is John, but he's not the light. He comes to testify to the light. And then John is the one that says, man, let me clarify. I was actually sent to be the forerunner, the person preparing the way for one. I'm not even worthy to tie up his sandals. People ask him, well then, who are you, John? Are you the prophet that was originally prophesied, was coming? Are you the Messiah? John says, I'm not the prophet. I'm not the Messiah. I'm not the Christ. They want to know, why are you baptizing then? He says, the reason I'm baptizing is to prepare you to know that he is among us already, that this promised one, the prophet, the Christ, the Messiah, he is among us, and at Jesus' baptism, the Holy Spirit confirmed it. And then John says, I must become lesser, he must become greater, and slowly over time, his disciples leave that preparatory stage where John was leading them and become disciples of Jesus where he is leading them. So the people in Ephesus are discovering that as they were sorting out who is Jesus to them, the Gospel of John is showing that this was the process everyone was working through. That throughout the Gospel of John, whether it's kind of our star character in Nicodemus or any of the other characters, they're sorting out who is Jesus. Now, given that, we've also discovered that Jesus, as he was revealing God, was on a time schedule, so to speak. And that's the way we would think about it, but there is this hour that's coming. There is an hour, according to chapter 2, when he's in the wedding at Cana, his hour has not yet come. There's times when people want to arrest him, but they are unable because his hour has not yet come. But in chapter 12, Jesus says, the hour has come. So look with me now in chapter 12, and let's read beginning in verse 23. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now bear in mind, he's referring to himself using that favorite term, Son of Man. But notice it says the hour has come for him to be glorified. Now, one thing we might ask is, well, how would we know if the hour has come? Jesus begins to talk about this. He says, "Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds." So now I'm in chapter 12, 25. "Anyone who loves their life will lose it, but whoever hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No. It was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." Well, the crowd that was there heard it, and some said it had thundered. Others said, well, an angel spoke to him. But Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. So he is linking the hour of glorification to his death. Now, if you can stop and think about this for a few moments, this glory theme goes throughout scripture, throughout the gospel. In fact, it is used so often in the Gospel of John, okay? From the best estimates of transcripts in the New Testament, the word glory and its derivatives is used about 42 times in the Gospel of John alone. There are a couple of articles that have helped me tremendously in my study. One of them by Dr. Robert Cook. He's written the article, "The Glory Motif in the Johannine Corpus," meaning, of course, John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and Revelation. Another article that was of great assistance to me in my preparation was called "The Book of Glory: Jesus Teaches His Disciples," and this is taken from the book New Testament Writings by Dr. Luke Timothy Johnson, professor of New Testament at Candler School of Theology, Emory University in Atlanta. Now, when you think these two documents, one of the things they do is help us understand that the book of John is being referred to as the book of glory because this theme is so dominant. You remember, if you followed our whole series, if you go back to John chapter 1, in verses 1 through 18, we have the prologue of John. We noted in the beginning that every significant theme in the Gospel of John is referenced in one way or another in chapter 1, and most of the significant themes are referenced in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. The glory motif is no different. Look with me at John 1 and verse 14. "The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us." Watch this. "We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only who has come from the Father, full of grace and truth." Now, what have we seen? We've beheld His glory. So what is glory? Well, the Old Testament backdrop of the word glory primarily references a word, kavod. And the word kavod has the connotation of something weighty, something extremely important and substantive, okay? When you come into New Testament times, the word glory is used in secular language. But it's not exactly used exactly the same way that it's used in the Bible. Some people talk about kind of what we would call anticipatory glory, where someone is speaking of their own opinion of themselves, meaning that they would have a opinion of themselves anticipating the future, that they would accomplish some things, succeed at some things, that they would have influence and perhaps position. But the second meaning in secular terms might be what we might call reputation. So one of them is an opinion kind of anticipating the future. The other one is reputation, kind of marking what's already happened in the past. What is the substantive work that someone has done, the lifestyle, the things that person is known for? When you come into the New Testament, though, you're mixing those base themes with this rich idea of the kavod, the glory of God. So actually, rather than just anticipating something that might happen in the future, or maybe the sometimes uncertain ways that people build a reputation, this word glory actually means essence or substance. The glory of God is the presence of God. It is the work of God, the splendor of God, the majesty of God. So it's the substance of God. So when it says that the Word became flesh, this tangible flesh, we beheld His glory, His substance, His weight, His position, His splendor. And how does He identify it? Is it the splendor of humanity? No. He says it was the glory of the one and only from the Father. So this glory of Jesus is the presence of God, the brightness of God, the majesty of God, the splendor of God, the power of God, the action of God. So turn with me to chapter 2. In the turning of the water to wine, we know the story, and it's a marvelous story. Jesus creates the wine, or turns the water to wine. It does this fantastic thing, but notice what it says in verse 11. What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of His miraculous signs, I'm in chapter 2 and verse 11, through which He revealed His glory, and His disciples believed in Him. We know John's purpose was to tell us these signs, specifically these seven key signs, so that people could believe. And it says they did believe, but notice it says He revealed His glory. So this glory is not human reputation. It is the work of God, the presence of God, the power of God, the splendor of God in Jesus Christ. So when we think about the glory theme, it continues through Scripture. When Jesus says, "My hour has not yet come," in chapter 7. So bringing these themes together, His hour has not yet come. If you remember chapter 7, look with me again at verses 37 through 39. In chapter 7 and verses 37 to 39, "On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, 'Anyone who is thirsty, come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them.' By this, He meant the Spirit," that's our theme from the last lecture, "who they were later to receive. The Spirit had not yet been given since," chapter 7 of verse 39, "Jesus had not yet been glorified." So in chapter 7, we have these three themes merged. Why doesn't He go up to the festival at the beginning? His hour has not yet come. When He does go to the festival, what does He declare is coming? The Holy Spirit in a fresh way. But when is it going to happen? When His glorification is accomplished. So we see this theme unfolding, but on different levels. So we behold in Jesus the glory of God. Jesus demonstrates His glory in the miracle. But then there is a glorification of Jesus that is going to come as he fulfills the purpose for which he has come. Turn with me now to chapter 11, and this is in the discussion of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. While you're turning there to chapter 11, you'll recall that this is the seventh and most profound of the miracles. So in this seventh miracle, where Jesus is also going to give an I am statement, he says, beginning in chapter 11 and verse 1, "Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha." Then John explains for his audience, remember, that's removed from the situation, "This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who had poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, 'Lord, the one you love is sick.' When Jesus heard this, Jesus said, 'This sickness will not end in death.' No," this is chapter 11 and verse 4, "it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now, what is that about? He says, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. Do you know the story? You remember the story? Lazarus rises from the dead. So, of course, his sickness didn't end in death. He doesn't mean that. He means, again, as we've studied this before, as Tom Wright says in his book, John for Everyone, the story about Lazarus isn't just about Lazarus. It's about Jesus. Jesus says, the story isn't just about me, it's about God. So Lazarus's sickness won't end in death. Will he die? Yes. Will he be raised? Yes. Is that the end? No. We're on to the glory of God. And not only will God be glorified, but Jesus will be glorified through it. So Jesus tells his disciples, we've got to go and do this work, because as it is day, we're going to do the works of God. So then he says in verse 14, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake, I'm glad I was not there. Why? So that you may believe." Do you see another theme being brought in? So in the theme of glory, what have we seen? The incarnation of Jesus. Jesus in the flesh. In the miracle, what did we see? Well, Jesus demonstrating his glory. Then what do we hear in chapter 7? There's a glorification moment coming, which is tied into the hour and the Spirit. What do we have here? Well, tied into the work of God and tied into what Jesus is going to do so that they'll believe is Jesus' miracle in raising Lazarus from the dead. So all of these themes are woven in to the glory theme. Can we back up now to chapter 8? In chapter 8, we give a different view of the glory theme. Turn to chapter 8 and let's begin in verse 48. Jesus is in a very tense conversation with his opposition. It says, the Jews answered him, "Aren't we right in saying you're a Samaritan and demon-possessed?" Now, I got to tell you, that's like cussing in the first century in their world. He says in verse 49, "I am not possessed by a demon, but I honor my Father and you dishonor me. I'm not seeking glory for myself, but there is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Very truly I tell you, whoever obeys my word will never see death." Notice that Jesus says, "I'm not seeking glory for myself. There is one who seeks it, and deservedly so." What is the chief end of men? The chief end of humanity? It is to glorify God. But what does that glory mean? Well, Jesus gives us a hint. "I'm not here for glory," meaning what? "I'm not here to take something that belongs only to God. I'm not here to receive something that belongs only to God." You see, they were used to getting the praise of each other, and that satisfied them. Jesus said, the only glory I'm interested in is the glory of God. And the glory that I want to give is glory to God. So the theme continues in the Gospel of John. We've noted chapter 12, where this glorification moment was coming. So let's follow that up in chapter 13. Turn to chapter 13 and look with me at verses 31 and following. Chapter 13. When he was gone, Jesus said, now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. Notice that the glory of God and the glorification of God is wrapped up in the glory of Christ and the glorification of Christ. So Jesus says, I'm concerned about God's glory, and God will glorify me. And when I am glorified, meaning this moment that he's about to move into in just a few hours, God will be glorified. So the kavod of God, the splendor, the brightness, the substance, the power, the action, the purpose, the personhood of God is wrapped up in this term glory. So Jesus can speak of the glorification that is coming because he's fulfilling what he came to do as God in the flesh. Turn with me now, if you would, to chapter 16. In 16, we're going to begin in verse 12. Jesus says, and you remember this was in our previous session, I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. Now look at verse 14, 16, 14. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he makes known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. So notice that the Spirit coming is going to glorify Christ. So Jesus says, why am I here? I'm here to reveal the glory of God, to give glory to God, to fulfill what the glory of God does. And in that, I will be glorified. And when I send the Spirit in this new way, he will bring glory to me. Why? Because just as everything I have is from the Father, so everything the Spirit has is from me. Now notice, if you would, chapter 17. In chapter 17, Jesus has moved beyond this farewell discourse. This is after the Last Supper, after the washing of the disciples' feet, after Judas has already left to go betray Jesus. He has this conversation, the end of 13, 14, and 15, and 16. Then, before Judas returns with the detachment of soldiers to arrest Jesus, Jesus has this prayer. This might actually be the Lord's Prayer. It's the longest prayer of Jesus in Scripture, and it's beautiful. But read with me John 17, beginning in verse 1. After Jesus had said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people that he might give eternal life to all you've given him. Now, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Now that's stunning, because in those first five verses, it's like we have all the major themes of the Gospel of John. Jesus is the one sent. He's the coming one. He has come from the Father, but He is one with the Father. He is the one that has come to finish the redemptive work of God, and in doing so, He's glorifying the Father. Now the Father's going to glorify Him. But notice the last thing He says, and this is so important. Jesus says, glorify Me with what? Now I want you to look at it, John 17:5, with what? Glorify Me in Your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Let's go back to John 1. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. You can say this with me now, right? And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And through Him, all things were made. Apart from Him, nothing was made that has been made. And verse 14, that Word, who is the Creator with God, that Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. What does Jesus say? I had glory before I came in flesh, and when I came in flesh, I had glory. I revealed the glory of God. I showed it in the miracles. I showed it in my life. I brought the substance of God, the glory of God, to every moral decision, every ethical decision, and every teaching. I did not succumb to the temptation to seek the glory or the praise of humans, because the only thing I cared about was the glory of God and giving glory to God. If I want anybody to give me glory, Jesus says, it's only the glory of the Father, and I have devoted myself to giving Him glory. In my glorification, the fulfilling of this divine purpose, the death, burial, and resurrection, I will be glorified and God will be glorified. And it was for this hour that I have come. And when the Spirit comes, He will bring me glory. You see, Jesus dwelled in the pre-incarnate, pre-flesh glory. He dwelled in glory in the flesh. He revealed the glory of God in substance, reputation. He was the one that brought the reality of God to confront the false suppositions of God. His miracles reveal His glory. His moral and ethics reveal His glory. His death, burial, and resurrection reveal His glory. And He is going to return to glory. But then He says something that should give us pause. Look at chapter 17, and let's begin reading in verse 20. 17:20. Jesus continues His prayer, and He says, my prayer is not for them alone. He's been praying for His disciples. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray for those who will believe in Me through their message. Now, who would that be? Well, I know, us. Not just us, but John's original audience. Remember back in chapter 10, Jesus said, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen, and I must get them, and I'll bring them in, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Look what He does again. He reaches out across time to the audience at that Western modern-day Turkey audience around Ephesus, and he has His echo in their ears. I'm not just praying for the disciples now. I'm praying for everyone who will believe in their message. And that also echoes all the way down to right now. He's praying for us. And He says, just that they may all be one. Verse 21, Father, just as You are in Me and I am in You, may they also be in us, that the world may believe that You sent Me. Underline verse 22. I have given them the glory that You gave Me, that they may be one as We are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Did you catch that? Jesus says, I have given them my glory. We're included. But included in what? We're not just included, and this is critical, in eternal glory. Jesus still hasn't ascended. Yes, that's coming, where we will enter glory by and by, but there's more to it than that. We're going to share in the kavod. We're going to share in the weightiness, the substance of God. The glory of God is being given to us. The personhood of God is being given to us. The Holy Spirit, as we studied in our last session, is going to come into us, bringing God into us, dwelling in us, animating us, enlivening us, the Spirit giving life to us. So the substance of God in us. So people will be able to behold the glory of God in His people, in you, in me. So it's the love of God, the justice of God, the mercy of God, the forgiveness of God, the truth of God. Not one of those qualities, the glory surrounds all of those qualities. As Dr. Cook says in his article, glory isn't an attribute of God, glory is in all the attributes of God. So when we come in belief to Christ and believe that He is the Son of God, that we want life in His name, as we receive the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, we have been born from above of water and Spirit. Jesus says, I'm giving you my glory. What is He returning to? The glory God gave Him before had with Him before the foundations of the world. So while we're on this earth, dwelling among others, a really great question to ask is, are they experiencing the glory that Jesus gave us? The substance of God, the brightness of God, the splendor of God, the majesty of God. You see, everything is tied together in the glory theme. Jesus had glory, He comes in glory, He serves in glory, He lives in glory. He builds His whole life around an hour to glorify the name of God, and in glorifying God, He is glorified. And in completing that hour of glory, the Holy Spirit comes to continue the glory of God. You see, Jesus is the one who, because of His substance, because of the glory of God, because it's God in the flesh, He's the one who can say, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that man would not perish. Why? Why can He make that promise? Because He's God in the flesh, and the glory of God, the substance of God, is within Him. So we need to believe that He so loved me, you, that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever would believe in Him wouldn't perish, but would have everlasting life. We need to believe, verse 17, that God didn't send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. We need to believe that there's living water available to us, and that the Spirit will be given without limit. We need to believe that we can be comforted when Jesus says, let not your heart be troubled. I have a place for you. And that I'm going to prepare that place for you. And you can believe that I will come again. How do you know Jesus is coming again? Because of the glory of God, the substance of God. When He says it, it is substance. It is tangible. How tangible was Jesus? In the flesh. How dependable are His promises? As tangible as He was in the flesh. When Jesus says, don't fear, I've overcome the world, we can believe it because of the glory of God. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world." He told Pilate, "You'd have no power over me if it wasn't given you from above." So he can come to his disciples and say, "Peace." After the resurrection, they're huddled away in a room. The doors are locked. They're afraid. And Jesus comes not once and twice says, "Peace. It's okay." Why? Because everything I've been is going to continue. That the body of Christ is the coming, continual coming of the people of God. It's Jesus in his people, the Spirit dwelling in them. That is why the glorious church, the glorious family of God, is still spreading the glory of God throughout the earth. There is a challenge in this glorification. Jesus said in John 12 that my glory includes a death. And I want you to think with me about that for a moment. He said, unless a kernel of wheat dies and falls to the ground, it remains a single seed. But if it dies, it comes to fruition of what it was made for. Jesus said, my servants are going to follow me. And if you love your life so much in this earth that you can't give up that life to receive life eternal, you're going to miss out on the glory. He says you got to hate your life in this world. Not hate in the emotional negative term that we use it. That word hate in the original language has more of an idea of neglect by degree. It's not, the word hate doesn't have to mean something emotional, like I hate another person. That's why when Jesus is recorded saying, you must hate mother, father, sister, brother, he doesn't mean hate them like in an emotional despising. One other gospel words it a different way that's the same message. You've got to love Jesus more. So the word hate doesn't have this negative connotation that you like hate trees and hate your flesh and hate bugs and birds. Well, you might hate a bug. I'm just teasing. It doesn't mean that. Hate means neglect by degree. That there's nothing as important as life in Christ, including death. That there's nothing we would hold on to from this life that would be more important than letting go of it and grasping life eternal. Jesus says, I'm going to lead the way. I'll do that first. I will be glorified in what? Being lifted up on an instrument of death, the cross. So it shouldn't be surprising to us that John saves a kicker. Look with me at when Jesus appears to his disciples in John 21. We know this story. This is after the resurrection, after they've seen him a few times, even after honest Thomas comes to faith. I know we call him doubting Thomas. I think he's just honest Thomas. I think there's more Thomas than most of us than we would admit. But remember, Thomas says, if I don't see him, I'm not going to believe. Jesus shows himself to Thomas, touches his hands, his side, looks at him and says, my Lord and my God. Thomas declares that Jesus is God. We start in chapter 1. We get all the way through to chapter 20. The whole gospel comes together. Jesus is the Word who is God, who became flesh, who revealed God. Finally, in this revelation, Thomas worships him, my Lord and my God. Jesus doesn't say, don't call me God, because Jesus has been declaring and revealing throughout the gospel that he is God in the flesh. When Thomas declares this, it shows us that as Jesus was God and we beheld his glory, that that glory was visible to Thomas and brought him to faith. Jesus says, though, that blessed are you, Thomas, because you saw and believed. How much more blessed are those who don't see and yet believe? Still reaching out to that future audience and reaching out to us. And then we get the purpose statement that all of these things were written so that we could believe. And then we come to chapter 21. When we come to chapter 21, Peter and some of the other disciples have gone fishing, and there's a kicker that's still coming. It says that Jesus went out and was on the beach there. They're out in the boat. This is kind of reminiscent of earlier examples. Jesus kind of calls out, "Hey, have you caught any fish?" You know, their response back from out there, "No, we haven't got any fish." And so he tells them, "Well, throw the nets on the other side." And, you know, this, they got to be thinking, "Man, I've heard this somewhere before. Is this deja vu?" You know, but they throw them on the other side. They catch 153 fish. We've got the situation where the boat's kind of going to sink and everything. And then let's pick up on what happens. He says in verse 7, "Then the disciple whom Jesus loved," this is our disciple, John, that wrote this gospel, "said to Simon Peter, 'It's the Lord.' And as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, 'It's the Lord,' he wrapped his outer garment around him," and he'd taken it off, of course, for the fishing, "jumped into the water. The other disciples followed. They're towing in the net full of fish. And then they get there, and when they landed," verse 9, "they saw fire burning coals with some fish on it and some bread." Has Jesus already been fishing? I would really have loved to have eaten a breakfast that Jesus cooked, okay? But he's cooking some fish and some bread. He says, "Bring some of the fish you've caught." They bring up some of the 153 fish that they did. And then that Jesus says to him in verse 12, "Have some breakfast." Now notice it says, none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. So you say, you notice that once they get up close, it's like, oh man, it is him. See, there's still this level of, could this have actually happened? Well, now notice what happens. Verse 15. "When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?' 'Well, yes, Lord,' he said. 'You know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Feed my lambs.' Again, Jesus said, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' Well, he answered, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Take care of my sheep.' The third time he said to him, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' And Peter was hurt because Jesus had asked him the third time, 'Do you love me?' He said, 'Lord, you know all these things. You know that I love you.' And Jesus said, 'Feed my sheep.'" Now, before we complete this, I want to note that I'm certain that as you read this, it could be somewhat confusing. Why does Jesus ask him three times? It's a mystery. Some scholars would point to the fact that Peter denied him three times, so maybe this mirrors three denials and three confessions. Now, on another level, scholars have noted that Jesus asks Peter, "Do you love me?" using the highest form of love in the Greek language, the word agape. Peter answers with another form of love in the Greek language, phileo, the word we use in Philadelphia for the city of brotherly love, phileo, to love. So Jesus asked, "Do you love me with this kind of love?" Peter says, "I love you with this kind of love." That's how the first two questions go. The third question Jesus asks, "Do you love me with phileo?" And Peter says, "I love you with phileo." Now I want to make a point here that I think is important. Do not make the mistake of downgrading the form of love contained in phileo. In chapter 5 of John, that word phileo is used to describe the love God has for Jesus. So you don't want to downgrade that love. What it actually is, I think, is happening is Jesus is saying, "Peter, you tried to make it sound like and you believed that you were this far along. You know, the whole, I'll never betray you, even if everybody else does, his own friends, I won't do it, you know, I'll die for you, I'll go to prison for you." Jesus says, "Actually, you're going to deny me." Peter says, "Not on your life, it'll never happen." And then it happens. But you recall, perhaps, in Luke 22, where Jesus said, "Simon, Simon, Satan has demanded to sift you all like wheat, Now, I know in some translations it says demanded to sift you like wheat, but in the original language, that's plural, that you. Jesus says, the way we might say it here in Atlanta, Georgia, where I'm taping is, Satan's demanded to sift y'all like wheat. But then Jesus makes it personal. But Simon, I've prayed for you that your faith may not fail, and when you've returned, strengthen your brothers. So there is this general sense in which Satan is trying to get them all. But Peter, I'm praying for you. And what does Jesus say? That your faith won't fail. But when you return, strengthen your brothers, which means what? I'm anticipating your struggle. How does Peter respond? There will be no struggle with me. But there is. So perhaps in John 21, Jesus is suggesting, you understand, Peter, what would be better is if you knew where you were and understand that I accept you where you are. You don't have to be somewhere you're not, but I want you to know that I receive you where you are. And I think Peter comes to peace with that. Well, then Jesus says, again, feed my sheep. Now, I want you to focus with me on verse 18. Jesus still speaking to Peter. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Look at verse 19. Underline it. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. So notice that in all the ways that Jesus has given us His glory and that Jesus' life was going toward an hour of glorification, that Jesus says, Father, glorify Your name. Jesus says, Father, glorify Me. Why? Because I finished the work You gave Me to do. He now says to Peter, you understand that everything that glory means, the substance of God, the purpose of God, the action of God, giving God glory with your life, I'm now passing that on to you. So just as Jesus glorified God through His death, what's Peter going to do? He's going to glorify God through His death. So when Jesus says, when you were young, you dressed yourself and all of that, what He's saying is when you're older, you're going to stick out your hands, they're going to bind Him. And they're going to kill Peter because he believes in Jesus. Jesus said back in chapter 16, I'm telling you ahead of time, there's going to be people that will kill you that think they're doing God's will. So in the glorification theme, not only are we drawn into it where Jesus says, I'm giving you My glory. He's also saying, I'm calling you to give glory to God. That in everything you would do, you would give glory to God. Now, let me ask you this. How would you feel about that? Then notice what Jesus says. Look at what He says. Then He said to Peter, this is at the end of verse 19, follow Me. But now this follow Me is not new. He said follow Me before, but what's the difference? The difference is now Peter knows the story. He knows the cost. Doing something following Jesus means you're on a road to glory. But it's the glory of God. So now when He says, follow Me, Peter knows the story. What's Jesus just been through? The death, burial, and resurrection. What is Peter going to go through? His own. So then notice what happens, verse 20. Well, Peter, like many of us, turns around and he saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, that's John, that was following them. This was the one, he clarifies, who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, Lord, who's going to betray You? So that's hearkening back to chapter 13 and the Last Supper. So Peter, having received this call that mentions his own death, says to Jesus, well, Lord, what about him? I promise you, we're not much different than Peter. If Jesus looked at you and says, hey, I just want to clarify. I know you love Me. We're back on the same page. I know you're My disciple. That means that you will die to give God glory. If we were in a group, we might kind of look around and say, hey, man, is this a group policy? I mean, we're all going down, right? You see, Peter's still struggling. And I promise you That first century audience in Ephesus under persecution, they can relate to this. And you know what? So can we. How many times have you stood for Christ and it seemed that others benefited from their deceit and you suffered, but you stood for Christ? How many times have you said the truth? How many times have you fought for justice? How many times have you given mercy, offered forgiveness, and it wasn't reciprocated? You see, we're giving glory to God by being that kernel of wheat that dies. That we don't love our lives so much that we fail to reach out for the life that only the Spirit gives. So Peter turns around like us and says, what about him? Verse 22, Jesus answered, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me. Discipleship is not comparative. It's not what's going on with me, what's going on with you, is it fair? And he's pretty pointed with Peter. Peter, this isn't about him. Whatever I want to do with him is my business. This is about you. And you realize Jesus is looking at you and me with the same look and saying, are you going to follow me? Don't worry about everybody else. You. John says, this is the disciple who testifies to these things. John says, this is me. This is the disciple. I'm in verse 24. I'm sorry. Let me go back to verse 23. Because of this, because of what Jesus said, a rumor had spread among the believers that this disciple would not die, but Jesus didn't say he wouldn't die. He only said, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? So John's clearing up a rumor that maybe still persisted in the time of the writing of his gospel. He said, that's just a rumor. This whole discussion was not about whether I'd live or die. He didn't say I'd live forever. He just said, I'll do with him what I want and you need to follow me. But then John says in verse 24, but this is me. This is the disciple who testifies to these things, who wrote them down, and we know that his testimony is true. Jesus did many other things as well. And if every one of them were written down, I suppose that not even the whole world would have room for the books that would be written. John says, listen, it's going to take all eternity for us to see all of the glory of God, all the works of Jesus. John says, I got to tell you, I was there and I only wrote down the ones that I could put in this book so that you could believe and have the same life I've received and be given the glory that Jesus promised. But he says, you understand, your road to glory isn't just a road that happens someday. That road to glory has already started. You're already bringing the presence of God and the substance of God to the world by the way you live and you manifest God in your life. As you let the Spirit take control, the glory of God pours through you. And that even might mean an hour in which you give your life for Christ physically, or the minute by minute giving up of the things of this world to claim life in Christ every day. But Jesus says, follow me. And John says, that's what I chose to do because I believed. And I hope that's what you'll do, is that you'll believe. And if you wish there was more evidence, we could fill the world with the evidence. But these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you might have life in his name. Thank you for joining me for this series. I hope you'll continue to study, and God bless you.